Hello everyone. You know, these are exceptional times and I thought we could spend a few minutes in discussing what brought us here today and how we are navigating our portfolios. You know, for the first time in human history, 210 countries have been infected at the same time. 30% of the world's population is shut, 100% of India is under lockdown, over 2 million are infected with the disease, and roughly about 3% dead. Now, it's good to look back at the Spanish flu over 100 years ago, when the fatality rate was about 20%. But since then, over the last 100 years, medical technology has improved dramatically. It took 2,345 years to develop a vaccine for cholera, roughly 500 years for a rubella vaccine, 15 years for an HIV vaccine, 5 years for an Ebola vaccine, and roughly we are looking at a one-year time frame before Corona, COVID-19 has an actual vaccine. And so far, you know, the next point that we are looking at is if there is a flattening of the curve. Now, as long as the 3% mark of fatalities is maintained, and in the larger context of things, it is within the range of common flus and other flu and other diseases which actually cause these fatalities. Now, what does it do to economies? Now, in India, the unemployment rate before this whole thing started was 6%. Very quickly in the month of March and now into the first 2 weeks of April, 25% of India is unemployed, and which is a big number of a nation of 1.3 billion people. Now, transportation, hotels, aircrafts, factories are everything shut, leading to a tremendous loss of income. Now, so it is fairly certain that next year, FY21, will be a recession. So there are two things in terms of a portfolio management. Is one, what the whole world and India has come to a standstill. And second, it will restart. In the case of India, a phased open up from April 20th, and May 3rd will probably be the next step. You will see that various industries come back with varying speeds. Now, and accordingly, we are positioning our portfolios. Look at IT. They are the most well-positioned. They have fantastic disaster recovery plans, working remote and traveling in and without travel, working through remote offshore locations. So the earnings hit for IT companies will probably be only about 2 or 3%. And the business, in more than anything else in the digital time and age, will accelerate for the IT industry. So that's a sector that we will clearly look to have a fairly big exposure. The second is pharmaceuticals. Over the last 2 or 3 years, you've had various FDA issues which have impacted the pharmaceutical sectors, but individually companies have been coming out one-on-one. Now, if you look forward into 2021, a few billion doses of the corona vaccine or therapeutic cures will be required in treating the world's population. Several Indian companies are working rapidly and extensively in developing some kind of vaccine. And there have been what you call some cures like hydrochloroquine, which are intermediary steps, and numerous Indian companies are benefiting from that. So that's another sector that we will look to. Now, we're going back to the unemployed population of 25%. The government will need to get these people back to work very quickly to avoid starvation in the country and also to economic activity. For that, infrastructure as a sector, building roads, bridges, dams, is where all these workers can come back. Now, there you have a positive and a negative. The positive is the workers will very quickly find job as long as the government is able to mobilize the migrant workers back from their villages and back to construction sites. So in this case, southern companies where the migration has been lower will be faster to rebound. In northern India, the migration has been higher and they will take some more time to reset. Meanwhile, it's important to look at what has happened to crude. Oil, which India is a big importer of, is down about 60% over the last 12 months. These are very big numbers. Now, India being an importer benefits from a fall in crude. and numerous process industries like cement. Now, cement is connected to infrastructure. Cement is also connected to a lot of construction activity, which will all come back fairly rapidly in various states. And their input costs, which are all crude linked, are down significantly, which will also help in the profitability of these companies. Now, other companies, paints, an important raw material is titanium dioxide, which is an oil derivative. And so those prices have come down significantly. Now, other sectors where you'd look at consumer goods, now companies like Relaxo or Bata, they make footwear, but guess what? Nearly 70% of their raw material is crude linked. So they will benefit fairly quickly. Now, in terms of consumer discretionary, autos, you know, after the lockdown, it is fairly unlikely that people will rush out to go and buy cars and bikes or come May 3rd. And that will probably take several months, probably 6 to 9 months for it to recover. On the other hand, some of the commercial vehicle sales will come back slightly ahead before the two-wheelers and four-wheelers come back to support an infrastructure spending. And mind you, as the companies report their numbers in the coming few weeks, it's going to be a fairly bad set of numbers. Company sales have fallen anywhere between 20% to 50% depending on the sector. Now, companies like sectors like IT and pharmaceuticals have been less impacted, probably about 2 to 4%. But in the case of financials or process industries where manufacturing is largely shut, the impact will be fairly high. Now, so it's not important to look at what has happened. In looking forward, we think that individual sectors like cement will come back fairly quickly. Deep infrastructure is unlikely to come back in a rush because, you know, the government also has its financials fairly in a tight shape. So in this environment, what does the government do? We think it should relax its fiscal deficit targets. 3.5 is a necessary target in the current times because these are exceptional times, and maybe they should take it up to about 5%, in that range of 5.5%, and we can get back to those targets roughly over the next year or two as the situation normalizes. In this backdrop, the RBI, Shaktikanta Das, has been doing a wonderful job, and he cut the rates recently 75 basis points. He is also providing liquidity to NBFCs and small medium organizations who are the worst hit. And there is also some kind of moratorium for, in the case of real estate companies, where they do not need to make repayments for the next 1 year. This is very important because, you know, construction activity has actually come to a stop, and it will take quite some time before the workers are mobilized and construction activity re-picks up and they sell unsold inventory. Now, so in terms of earnings, will FY21 will again see a further cut of probably about 15-20%. Now, if you rewind back into 2008 crisis, it was largely a financial shock. The demand was out there, but the liquidity was the problem. In other words, if you wanted to get onto a plane and go somewhere, you could do so. But in today's environment, you cannot do that because both supply and demand is locked. If you want to buy a car, you cannot go out and buy because the showrooms are closed and the factories are shut. And whenever there is a supply and demand shock which happens simultaneously, which is very rare, it's actually a three sigma event. Such an event has not happened in the last 100 years, as I said at the outset, which was the Spanish flu in 1918. But from then to now, central banks have learned a phenomenal amount. There's a far greater coordination. Human advances in medical technology have made producing new drugs over a very shorter time frame. So both demand and supply will come back up fairly quickly. Now, for them to come back up fairly quickly, the government will need to provide individual incentives for different sectors, like a payment repayment holiday, a moratorium, cutting off excise duties for some sectors, or maybe reducing temporarily GST rates for automobiles. We are fairly sure that the government is working on various packages, and the RBI governor had said that they are cognizant of the situation and ready to take more steps. So now, with the rate of infection slowing down, what is important is the flattening of the curve, and as that happens, confidence comes back into the system. And so, yes, there will continue to be new cases. Yes, there will be sudden spikes of infection over the following 6 to 8 months until some kind of vaccine is developed. But as long as it remains within the 3% range, the markets will readjust to themselves and look at FY22 and beyond. And accordingly, our portfolios are fairly nimble, recognizing the volatilities of the situation. And I think this is a great time with the markets down over 40%, the US market that is, and the Indian market likewise similar amount. It was the fastest correction in human history. And since the lows, US has rebounded 18%, India has rebounded 12%. So the biggest risk that one makes is in staying out of the market, because when the rebounds come, it's too little too late if you try to play a catch-up game. So stay invested, think long term, and stay safe. Thank you.